Today, you're not only gonna be able to answer exactly how much power you really need for your photography niche, but also what 200 and 400 and 600 watts of power even mean. It's not enough to just compare which light is the brightest. I wanna look at the overall use cases for working photographers, as well as the features that help make our job easier versus just marketing gimmicks. Later on, I'm gonna put these two lights head to head in real world environments on paid photo shoots to really understand how much light you can effectively get out of the 200 versus the 600. And that way you can make a more calculated decision on how much money you really need to spend and what is just marketing. Is the 8200 enough for you, or will you get the most out of your 600? I use these lights on a daily basis, and I've been shooting full time with these probably since like 2016 or 2017. The 200 really pushes above its weight class and will probably surprise you by the end of this video. But the 600 does give you a slew of features like faster recycle times for the same power output, a much easier menu system, and actually usable modeling lights even for video like this. So what's in it for you? And how much do you really need? What are the three key features that make up a good lighting system? Well, for me, the very most important thing is consistency. I don't want a dropped signal, I don't want to miss a shot, I don't want the colors to be all over the place. I don't do a whole lot of rapid shooting, so to speak, so a quick recycle time is not always pivotal to my specific workflow. In the few cases that it is for me, or maybe for you if you primarily shoot action or dancers or you shoot liquids a lot, whatever fast-moving subject it is, you may opt for multiple smaller lights to create the same output. Now, what I mean by that is instead of shooting with a single 8600 at full power, that gives you a recycle time of about a second and a flash duration of 1/200th, well, you can use maybe 6 8200s at half power for a quarter of the recycle time and 10 times shorter flash duration. I think of Joe McNally, who's pretty famous for being always on the go and has his pockets full of speed lights. Now, there really is no right or wrong lighting setup, only ones that fit your workflow. And it's adaptable to the variety of things that you shoot. I shoot very slowly, and at stop down apertures for the most part. So for me, I get more out of a bigger light with a simpler setup than multiple small lights. Now, whenever possible, I do like the idea of shooting things with only a single direct light source. Indirect bounces and fill is great because it doesn't add any additional catch lights. And I feel like for us, and at least in this solar system, we only have one sun. So it usually feels more natural to the viewer looking at an image with only a single light source. You really want to master a single flash before you move on to 2, 3, 4, and 5. So get the most out of a single flash with bounces and reflectors before you start implementing a second one. Of course, your mileage may vary, but I believe that as soon as you introduce a second or a third light source, be it for fashion portraits or products or even for cars, you start to create a more cinematic environment. Looks great, but usually removes you from the real of reality. Maybe that's exactly what you're going for, but maybe it's not. I just know that with a single light source and multiple reflectors or bounces with blocking and all that, you can create very dynamic images that don't fall flat, even with just one light. You don't need 8 lights to create a technically solid image. Now, because of the Lego-like adaptability of the Bowens reflectors, I kind of need my lights to be Bowens mount. There's adapters and brackets you can use, but when it's built into the flash like the 8600, it's just one less thing to think about. The most key feature for a good lighting system that fits my specific workflow is its ability to overpower any ambient light in any situation, period. I'm a commercial photographer, guys. I love getting to shoot out of my studio when I get a chance, but most of my work really does happen in a different environment every single day. There's always a different variable. It's super fun, don't get me wrong, but that means I have to travel with my stuff, I have to lug it around everywhere and set it up every day, and it has to work in dimly lit basements as well as corner offices with floor-to-ceiling windows. You can get lucky with natural light, but being a commercial photographer is not about being lucky. It's about delivering results to your clients. They don't care that the technical side of things is harder sometimes. They don't want to hear excuses. They just want a good shot that looks like the brief. It's up to you to troubleshoot and problem solve over and over again until it becomes second nature to you. Have the gear that you need to accomplish that issue. I reach for the 600s in almost every situation as my main lights because I know that they're powerful enough to completely black out a scene in the majority of indoor environments, even with large overhead fire exit lights. But even I feel like I'm pushing the limits of the output when it comes to like the restaurant over here at Mod that I did last week. This pizza joint is basically just a glass box and I was shooting here midday. So it's pretty bright and quite demanding for most flashes if you're starting from zero. A flash's brightness is usually advertised as wattage and still measured in guide numbers as if we're still shooting film. You know, like back when you had to do math to figure out your exposure or else it costed you money. Nowadays, we just shoot a frame and if it's not accurate, we'll just tweak it until it is. But guide numbers are determined as your f-stop times the subject distance, either in metric or in stupid. Doesn't really matter as long as you're consistent. It also assumes that your zoom and your ISO remain constant as well. But let's say you want to find out what exposure to set your aperture, and your flash has a guide number of 20 meters, for example. If your subject is 5 meters away, you would get a proper exposure at f4, at least with a standard reflector at full power. If you want to add a pop of light to your scene, some background fill, or supplementary key, an AD200 with a guide number of 60 will be plenty for most situations. For my workflow, since I start from a blank frame to control my lighting, I ask a lot more out of my gear. In this restaurant here, I know that to have a completely black frame, I need to be at f11, or at least want to be at f11 so that everything is decently in focus. And with the layout of the restaurant, my flash has to be about 5 meters away from the scene to give me the proper angle for the shot, as well as just illuminate it evenly across. So f11 times 5 is 55. I need a flash with a guide number of at least 55 meters to expose my scene properly, assuming no diffusion. For these images though, I've got my scrim up here because I wanted something a little bit more forgiving, even though still punchy. And since I've got it right up next to the flash, it basically just removes the specularity, but still cuts about a stop of light. So that cuts the output in half, which would give us a effective guide number of 80 meters to effectively light the scene. All to say is that the 8200s have a guide number of 52 with the Fresnel head and 60 with the bare bulb, and though it would get me close to where I want to be without the diffusion, the 8600's guide number of 87 keeps me reaching back for these time and time again. As with every other restaurant owner, they're always like, oh, do you want to set up over here? Is the lighting okay in the corner here? It honestly, it really makes no difference. The lighting is entirely controlled by me. The beauty of understanding your flashes inside and out is knowing that no matter where you set up, you can control the look of your images no matter what. I really can't stress this enough, guys. Nothing is left to chance. Every day's output should be identical regardless of the external factors. Now, of course, as artists, that's a little boring. I didn't get into this creative field to just be repetitive. I want some variety too. But because I start every photo shoot with just a black frame, I get to kind of paint my light in the scene wherever I want it, and that gives me a little bit of interest depending on the subject that I'm shooting. For these restaurants, I want it to be simple enough to set it up once and shoot the whole menu identically. But I still do like to keep it somewhat interesting by changing backgrounds or introducing props. These here are from Propface. I'll leave a link down in the description if you're interested in picking some up. I just like them because they're matte and eliminate that glaring reflection from the flash. Even if I'm using the same texture or color as the table underneath, sometimes you'll get a pretty greasy table to work on, and when you're shooting with flash, it'll completely wash out and kind of look distracting for the most part. I use my 600s because of their modeling light, especially for video, like this. Even if it's not perfect because I bought these for photo originally, this is just a great added feature that is getting me by until I can go pick up some dedicated video lights. Their ability to overpower the sun, at least for flashes, in any indoor environment keeps them worth their weight in gold for me and my workflow. I am still longing for the 1200. These will do for me at least for now. If you guys got something out of this video, let me know down in the comments. Maybe hit this video over here to see these lights in action. And I'll see you guys next week. Peace.